Hello everyone and welcome again to our channel. Today will be the first episode of an upcoming tech info series. In this series we'll cover some of the more technical aspects of our niche. In this first episode we're going to uncover the secrets of chiptuning. How does it all work? What you have to take into considerations? What are the risks? What are the pros? What are the cons? Well, we're all about to explain in a minute. Stay tuned. We'll cover today a subject that's a bit classified under top secret. What's the truth about chiptuning and how does it all work? I challenge you to go to a tuning shop and ask an explanation what will be changed to your car software to make it produce more power. There's absolutely no magic science to tuning a car. It just comes down on knowing how engines work and how they produce power, which differs between petrol and diesel engines. More about it later on. First, we need to have the original software file of the car to have a starting point to make the adjustments. This can happen most of the time with specialized equipment through the diagnostic port. You connect the tool and read out the original file of the engine control unit. Or in some cases, we were able to use a virtual read, which is basically a file downloaded from the tuning tool server, but specific for your car, based on engine type, country, equipment, etc. Now we have the original file, the tuning process can start. We load in the file and start editing. But what are we editing? Depending on engine type, petrol or diesel, we need to change different things. But explained in short, the more fuel you can inject, the more power you can make. A diesel engine is a so-called compression ignition engine. They work by compressing only the air. This increases the air temperature inside the cylinder to such a high degree that the injected diesel in the combustion chamber ignites spontaneously. The torque a diesel engine produces depends on the amount of fuel injected and the air-fuel ratio, also referred to as lambda. So instead of using a throttle plate to regulate the torque, we regulate the amount of fuel injected into the engine. The only reason modern diesel engines have a throttle is to shut down the engine or to be used to alter the amount of air entering the engine when the particle filter is regenerating. Knowing this, the key to making more power is to be able to inject more fuel into the engine. In order to do this, we need to be sure we have enough air in the engine, because if not, the car will start smoking. But not only this, when a diesel engine starts smoking, it means the air-fuel ratio is quite rich, which, unlike in a petrol engine, creates higher combustion temperatures that can damage the engine components or even your turbo. So in order to have enough air in the engine, also referred to air mass, we need to up the turbo pressure in most cases to be able to have controlled air-fuel mixture. This all being said, we can head over to petrol engines. A petrol engine is an internal combustion engine with spark ignition, designed to run on petrol or in some cases ethanol. The process differs from a diesel engine in the method of mixing fuel and air, and in using spark plugs to initiate the combustion process. In a petrol engine, the amount of torque also depends on the amount of fuel you can burn, but compared to a diesel engine, where the fuel mixture can be everywhere from lambda 1 until lambda 165, a petrol engine is very dependent on this air-fuel mixture. If the mixture is too lean, the car will balk or even start misfiring. Same goes the other way around. If it's too rich, the spark plugs will become wet and you will have misfires as well. So, it's pretty natural that the amount of air entering a petrol engine has to be regulated quite accurately. This is being done by the throttle plate, which is directly related to the amount of torque a petrol engine produces. So, the key to making more power in a petrol engine is, unlike a diesel engine, to get more air into the engine, so we can inject more fuel, thus making more power. This also explains why the power gains on natural aspirated engines are very minimal, because we can't get much more air into the engine. On a turbo engine, this is more easily achieved by altering the boost pressure. We still have some other factors which aid the power output, such as the moment we inject in a diesel engine or the moment we activate the spark plugs on a petrol engine, but these are the key factors. So now we know what we have to change and we can start making a file, write it back into the car and then test it on a dyno to see the difference in the change made. It's also very important to data log while doing a dyno test, to monitor that all the variables stay between the safety margins. Even if this sounds all very attractive, there are still some things to take into consideration. Tuning an engine is one thing, but reliability is another one. That said, we always have to take into account the ability of the engine and its drivetrain components to withstand the power increase, so you have to be careful. As with all things in life, chiptuning has its pros and its cons. The pros are quite simple: more driving pleasure, faster acceleration, better ability to tow, for example, a holiday caravan, and so on. On the other hand, there are also some cons, such as more tire wear, some legal issues in some countries due to the homologation of the vehicle, and if you have a reckless tuner, you also have the risk of engine failure. For this particular reason, I always keep engine protection functions active. There are also some theories on fuel savings, but we'll cover this topic in another upcoming video. So, this was it for today. If you still have some questions or suggestions for a subject for the tech series, feel free to put them in the comments and we'll do our very best to answer them. If you liked our content, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. So, see you next time!